Like to call the Iberia Parish Council meeting October 14th, 2015, to order. We just want to remind everyone, please check your devices. Make sure everything's on silent. As we've been reminded that October is Breast Cancer Month, we'd like to have a moment of silence for all the breast cancer patients, victims, those who have paid the loss to the battle to breast cancer, and as well as the survivors. We'd have a moment of silence. Ms. Daniels, would you lead us in prayer?
Most gracious and heavenly Father, dear God, we give you the praise, we give you the glory. Lord, we thank you for everything that you have done for us. Lord, we ask that you order our steps as we conduct this meeting to do what is best for the people of Iberia Parish. Lord, I also want to thank you personally for watching over me, for I am a 6-year survivor. I thank you for the doctors and the nurses, but especially those individuals who raise money for this cause. Lord, we ask that after this meeting, that you dispatch your angels to watch over us as we travel near and far. We beg a prayer for our troops that are near and far and for the President of the United States. Lord, we ask you all these things in Jesus' name. Let us all say amen.
Amen.
Mr. Wayne Romero, would you lead us in pledge?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As we have just faced the flag, it's been some time coming, but just want to acknowledge the fact that our plaque has finally arrived and been installed. It is quite different than what I had pictured it would be. But nevertheless, it's here, and we're proud to have it displayed. Well, I'll speak for myself. I'm proud to have it displayed. And I want to send out another kudos to Mr. Mike Fugelet from St. Martinville, who took it upon himself to make that a mission in having those words displayed in many, many public chambers across the state of Louisiana. All right, having said that, we'll ask for roll call.
Maggie Daniels.
Here.
J.D. Davis.
Here.
Tommy Landry. Lloyd Brown.
Here.
Troy Como.
Here.
Bernard Broussard.
Here.
David Ditch.
Here.
Ricky Gosselin.
Here.
Lynn Romero.
Here.
Roger Duncan.
Here.
Jerome Fitch.
Here.
Ethan Marina Arnold.
Here.
Marty Trahan. Wayne Romero.
Here.
We have a quorum. We'll get started. Oh, yes. Mr. Landry is not with us tonight. He is recuperating from a surgery and improving daily, from what I understand. And Mr. Trahan is also battling some health issues, so I apologize. We should have probably recognized and kept them in our prayers as well. So we ask you to do that later on at your own private time. But they do both wish that they could be here on this wonderful occasion. Approval of minutes, regular meeting of September 23rd, 2015.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Brown, second by Ms. Arnold. Discussion, comments, roll call. That motion carries. Persons to address the council, Dr. Lottie Beebe, to address the council to announce her candidacy for the District 3 representative seat of the Board of Elementary and Secondary Education. Bessie, welcome.
Good evening, members of the council and certainly members of the audience. And I come before you as the incumbent Bessie member representing District 3. I am seeking re-election to this seat, and Bessie District 3 consists of 15 parishes, Iberia, Terrebonne, Lafourche. I'm not going to name all of them, but I do want you to know that I have provided you with a handout that identifies those parishes I represent. I will also say that I am seeking the position because I have the experience. I have 32 years as an educator. I have served in both St. Landry Parish, St. Martin Parish. I currently serve as the superintendent of St. Martin Parish, and I served 8 years as a local school board member, and I have the experience, as I said, as a member of BSEE. I've served one term. And so I'm here today to ask for you to give me your consideration, support, and vote on October 24th. My number is 36 on the ballot, and I do realize some of you may have already voted with early voting, but then, of course, Saturday, October 24th, is the official day to vote. And some of you may wonder, well, you've served 4 years on BSEE. Why are you seeking another term? And I am one who loves a challenge, and I don't believe that my job is yet complete. We have education chaos, as I'm sure that many of you know if you pay attention to news media reports, to the news reports. You will know that there's a lot of discussion about the Common Core standards, the Common Core agenda, the most recent PORC scores, grades 3 through 8. And I think that it's important to have the right leadership. I know one of the greatest issues facing educators in Louisiana is the lack of transparency. We have a state superintendent of education who is not completely honest and forthcoming with information. And more recently, we have had a public records request where we more or less compelled the state superintendent of education to put forth the preliminary raw scores. And yesterday, BSEE convened a meeting where we were asked to approve the cut scores. And of course, the vote, and as it has been for the last 4 years, pretty much been 7-4. And so we need to be engaged. I do know, as I go out and meet people in those 15 parishes that I mentioned, when I ask for support for BSEE, many respond, well, what is BSEE? So quite naturally, I say it's the Board of Elementary and Secondary Education. And I can speak to you, I come to you with the fact that I have been successful, and I attribute my success to education, because many years ago, I'm not going to tell you how many years ago, I grew up in I was born to poverty, and it's through the nurturing of teachers and others, and they stress the importance of education, that I am who I am today, and I always give glory to God first, but my education, and that's why I'm seeking this position. Because I'm passionate when it comes to education. And I will tell you, this is an unpaid position. I can't compete with my opponent. It's important for you, if you have not yet cast your vote, to ask, to do your research, who is investing in Louisiana's educational system. You might be surprised to find out that we have outside wealthy philanthropists who believe that they need to dictate education policies. So you may have heard me say, if you are connected to social media, what have you, I have said that I will stand up to these special interest groups, particularly the outside special interest groups, who are investing millions of dollars to claim 8 seats on BSEE. And of course, the governor appoints 3. There are 11 members. So we have to ask, why do we need outside influence to dictate Louisiana's education policies? This election is critical. And you know, we focus on the governor's election and the parish president. These are all important positions, but you have to realize that the State Board of Education is also important, because this board sets policies. And I know I have time limit. I have a time limit, because like I said, with my passion, I could continue to talk for hours. But I did provide you with my platform, the issues. We're losing teachers daily. We've had a mass exodus of teachers. Morale is low. And I don't care how great a program you have, if you don't have that quality teacher in the classroom, it's not going to happen. So if we're truly about impacting student achievement, we need to ensure that we have quality teachers in the classroom. We need responsible education policies, and I am the person who will represent parents, students, represent you. I take my position very seriously, and together we can. And I ask again for you to vote for me on either prior to or on October 4th. Thank you, and I welcome. I'll field any questions that you may have.
Good luck. Any questions? Comments? Thank you.
October 24th.
Oh,
October 4th is my birthday, but it was. But October 24th, thank you.
Thank you for
being
here.
And I do appreciate all of you, and I do take pleasure representing Iberia Parish.
Thank you for being here. Good luck to you. Item number two, City of New Iberia Councilwoman Natalie Roban to address the council to request additional funding as needed for the Daspit Road resurfacing project from Pole Street to the Daspit Supermarket. Rescheduled for November 10th at 2015 meeting. Item number three, representatives of Iberia Parish County Agent's Office to represent their annual report to the council.
Thank you, Mr. Como. On behalf of the LSU Ag Center, Iberia Extension Office, my name is Blair Hebert. I currently serve as the county agent and parish chairman, and I have some of our staff with us tonight. We have a folder in front of you with the LSU Ag Center logo. Please feel free to look at that. We have some highlights on there for you on the overall programming that we do. As you see on the PowerPoint, the LSU Ag Center is made up of the research stations, which we have one here in Iberia Parish in Generette. We have the extension offices, which we have. We used to be down here in the basement. Now we're next door at the annex, and also teaching effective last year. The College of Agriculture in the LSU system came under the administration of the LSU Ag Center. So that's the three entities. Inside of the LSU Ag Center, we also team up with Southern Ag Center. So we're a very fortunate parish. We're a very unique parish in that we have LSU Ag, Southern Ag, and a research station all in one location. And I'd like to think that you as our local partners have had something to do with that. Had we not had the local support we've had over the years, I don't know if we'd be able to say that. And there's not too many parishes in the state that can say they have all three of those. So we appreciate all the support. Of course, the extension service that we work in daily is made up of agriculture and natural resources, still kind of known as the county agent. FCS used to be known as home ec, and then our youth development is commonly known as 4-H. I pretty much deal with agriculture and natural resources. We have someone from Southern who helps out with the horticulture and school gardens, and he'll speak a little bit later on. But these are some of the major activities and functions that we do, and a lot of you have been a part of these over the years, and we appreciate your support, and we enjoy the opportunity to provide these programs to you. Also, as certain issues arise and come up, naturally, with us being the largest sugarcane producing parish in the state, and when you look at the land mass of Iberia Parish, for us to lead in any major crop, it's got to be that we've got a lot of our eggs in one basket, so to speak. And as long as things are good in the sugarcane industry, that's a good thing. But if we ever have a big major issue, we could be in trouble. So when things come up, we try to address those in the agriculture area, and one of the hottest buttons or hottest issues that's going to come up is how are we going to handle pesticide application, and those of you who apply pesticides, we're as agents, we're going to be going to some trainings and getting our producers on line with that, and also some of the issues with water quality we're dealing with. Next, we'll call on Ms. Mandy, our Family and Consumer Science agent, to discuss the area she works in.
And thank you again for all of your support. Just a couple of our programs that we deal with for our kids and our parents and adults in this parish. We have our Mentoring Moms program, which is a joint memorandum of understanding between the 16th Judicial District Attorney's Office and the LSU Ag Center. And what this program does is that it provides parenting for both moms and dads and also for some of our truant youth who are in the school system. And this is a very valuable program to our kids and to our parish. We also have the Healthy Beginnings Program, which was formerly the parenting Parents Preparing for Success. And these are for all our TANF recipients and also workforce development funds that parents or can receive from the state. But they do also have to go through some mandated parenting programs to receive those benefits. We do several nutrition and healthy living educational programs, lots of food safety and food preservation. One of our biggest youth programs that touches almost every kid in this parish is our Smart Bodies program. And this is our response to childhood obesity and preventing childhood obesity. This year, our Smart Bodies schools are Daspit Elementary. We will have Body Walk on November 20th at that school. Also, Highland Baptist will be on March 6th, and Dotson Elementary will participate on March 7th, and they will go actually walk to Highland Gym to have that program. We do nutrition education for our low-income audiences, and these can range from seniors to also some of our mothers and fathers who are working, and then also those people, the working poor. And we do also a Kid Chef summer camp for all of our 4th through 6th grade 4-H members in the parish. This past summer, we did it at Iberia Middle, and we had about 25 kids participate in the program for a week where they learned cooking, food safety, eating healthy foods, physical activity, and cooking healthy recipes. We're now going to call on our 4-H youth development agent, Christy Oliver, to present her portion of the program.
Thank you so much. We're just really excited this year to have 4-H in every public school and parochial school in the grades 4th to 12th. So that's a big accomplishment, and we want to thank you for your continued support. We have over 945 4-H club members. We also have school enrichment programs that include Youth Wetlands program, which are given to our teachers. It's a co-curriculum binder that has all of the supplies that they need to do all of the lessons that are involved in there. We also are focused on service learning in our 4-H program as well as community service. And we work hand in hand with our horticulture agent with school gardening and character development. Now 4-H, the 4-H program, a lot of people know it for our traditional agriculture that we still have, our livestock programs, which include cattle, goats, sheep, rabbits, poultry, and swine. And we just had our sugarcane festival, and many of you were there to see what a tremendous job our youth do taking care of their 4-H project. We still have our monthly club meetings that include not only the parliamentary procedure that the kids learn, and some of them here can probably run a meeting just as well as the adults here. We have educational programs. This year we're focusing on healthy living and also social media safety. Our Junior Leader Club is comprised of 8th to 12th grade members, and you will see them out in the community helping with our 4-H program and just different community services that we have. We have a SET Club, which is open to our 4th to 6th graders. It's Science, Engineering, and Technology. And so last week, if you were at our office, you could have seen our 4-Hers learning about trees and forestry, as well as dissecting owl pellets. So that was really cool. The kids were excited about that. Our Six Easy Bites program we're happy to have with Miss Mandy, and it's for our 4th to 6th graders, and they learn healthy living as well as food safety and nutrition. Shooting sports. Again, this is our second year having shooting sports in Iberia Parish. Right now, our target is archery. We hope to go into other disciplines in the future. So we also have a fashion and fabric club, which is open to 4th to 12th graders. They are on the sewing machines, being able to gain the knowledge to, you know, not only create items, but to also fix the ones that they already have. Now, summer camp is still a big deal here in Iberia Parish. This past year, we brought over 75 4th to 6th graders to Camp Grant Walker in Alexandria, Louisiana, where they participated in weeks with different educational programs. Challenge Camp is coming up for our 7th and 8th graders, which is a team building camp, which will be in November. 4-H University, we brought over 50 kids this past summer, and they spent the week as college students. They got to live in the dorms, and they got to compete in different educational programs and brought home many blue ribbons and won many trips. Also, we are thankful for our volunteers, not only youth, but adult. Our volunteers contribute time, talent, energy, and it's valued right now. The value of a volunteer is $22 an hour. So we're really excited to have our volunteers. Like I said, not only those adults here in the parish that volunteer, but our youth as well. And I guess we'll hand it over to Delaine, our horticulture agent.
All right, thank you, Ms. Christie, and good evening. And thank you all for allowing me to speak tonight. I'm also an agriculture agent as well, but my main focus since being here is horticulture. And one of the main missions, of course, as an extension agent, is to be the extension of the research center and the ag center itself, and to deliver educational programs to students, to farmers, or those that we work with. So by me, you know, working now as a horticulture agent here in this parish, I've been able to go inside the schools and teach and also, you know, offer programs to students to learn more about gardening. I've heard students ask, you know, where does food come from? Where do these different, you know, products come from? There was a student at one time I heard, he said, you know, how do you plant a chicken, for example? So basically what we do is educate him. So now he no longer has the idea of planting a chicken, but now planting vegetables, planting carrots, planting peas. So that's our main focus, and I've only been here a year so far. So and what I've been able to do is just go into a few schools and just offer them programs, and so far it seems like it's been, you know, pretty successful for the ones that I've gone into, such as Park Elementary. Sugarland has already had a successful garden, but basically just to, you know, continue to develop programs with these different schools in order to, you know, promote our mission, which is education. So that's what I have. Thank you.
Thanks to all our staff members who came up. Usually when we get to this point in the program, we ask our fisheries agent, Mr. Tom Email. He's the senior person on the staff. Hope I said that correctly. But he had something come up, and Tom, as y'all know, deals with all the environmental and watershed and fisheries and aquatics information for us. We also have Mr. Mark Shirley, who's housed out of Abbeville, and Ms. Tu Buey, who's housed out of the St. Mary Parish office, who assists with that. But, you know, Tom just wanted to put some pictures in here. I think one that's been a big, big hit for us, something we should be proud of, is what's happening over in Delcom. You know, that's our parish's other port, I like to call it. I grew up in Vermilion. I wish the name wouldn't have come out as Vermilion Bay Suite, but it is Vermilion Bay. It's not Iberia Bay, so that's how the name caught on. And they're taking stuff from there, and they're calling it Fresh Louisiana or Wild Caught, and it's a big hit, and it's going really well. Miss Manny has a few more slides for Mr. Tom on what we're doing with these things and making them. It's not in the old days where we just kind of went get things. People want things packaged, ready to go. You can get at the supermarket. And one of the big things that's been successful is over in Delcom. They have the farmers market. They have Delcom Direct. And now you can get online, you can get in touch with a boat. They'll tell you when they're coming into Delcom, and you can go pick up shrimp of this quality. And it's one of those things for us as consumers. The prices are very affordable this year, not too good for the shrimpers. But by cutting out the middlemen and dealing directly with the public, that's been a successful project. And in what you guys have done as a parish entity, what Tom's group has done with the whole Sea Grant folks to get these boat slips, to get these buildings done in Delcom. It's just so nice to drive up over there and do this. And I think it's something that Iberia Parish can hang its hat on and say, look, it's something we're doing right. It's something we're doing good. And we just happy and proud to be a part of it. We're going to close with our mission. I hope y'all know that. I hope y'all realize that when you see the LSU Ag Center and you see me or any of the staff, you're not just getting us. You're getting every person at the research station. You're getting the whole LSU College of Ag. You're getting everybody out at the main university. When you have a problem or an issue, if we can't solve it, we will get in touch with those people. And that's what we're here to do. And we cannot do everything we do without your support. And just lastly, I'd like to mention, if my math is right, this is my 17th annual report. And some of you have been in every one of those. Y'all were here before me, and unfortunately, some of you decided not to run for re-election. So next year when we come, we won't have the opportunity to see you. So we wish you the best. We thank you for all your past years of support. And if y'all have any questions, Mr. Como, we gladly answer them at this time. Also, I want to mention sugarcane is underway. The grinding season has started. we should be at full swing. Everybody kind of started slow. We had some labor issues. It doesn't look like we're going to have a world record crop this year. Tonnage is a little bit light, but sugar, the recoverable sugar, is fantastic. Ricky, if we could just put a little bit of weight on that, I think we'd all be happy and keep that price up there. Both mills in the parish are operating. I noticed some issues going on with one of the mills. We'll have to wait and see how that all folds out. And we have Mr. Guy here. We appreciate what y'all doing. We have a number that folks can call if they're not used of it. I know we have some new people to when we can start burning some sugar cane, that they can call, and we ask the farmers to call that number and say, look, this is Ricky Gonsolet. I'm cutting cane on this area. I'm going to be burning at this time. If anybody calls, that's what the black smoke is. And it's a real good system. So thank you.
Any questions for Mr. Blair before you? Yeah. Mr. Fitch?
Yes, Mr. Avery, are you anticipating any cuts to higher education this year?
Yeah, unfortunately, we've been cut for 7 years in a row, so what's the eighth year, I guess, is how I'm looking at it, Mr. Jerome, and I don't know what else we can do about it. With the way the state budget is made, they only can cut from two places, and when oil's at $40 or $50 a barrel, they're going to have a hard time making their budget. We did lose a 4-H agent the first week in September. If you had the Sugarcane Festival, you noticed we were minus an agent, and right now what we're being told is that we're going to wait and see what happens with the mid-year budget proposals, and we'll probably have to wait till July of 16 to see if that position can be filled. But we did get some good news on that. We may be able to do something with some part-time folks, and I'll probably be talking to the administration here on how that's all going to work out once we get all the paperwork done. But unfortunately, Mr. Jerome, the Ag Center started a retirement incentive program that will take place October 31st. So November 1st, there will be 50 less Ag Center employees of Extension Research and the College of Ag no longer coming to work. And I think that was done in anticipation of this. So hopefully our share of the mid-year budget cut could possibly be reduced, but that's purely speculative on my part. By no means am I in Baton Rouge making those big, tough decisions.
Would a resolution from this board asking our state legislators to fund the Ag Center at its previous year help?
I think that would be a tremendous help if we could get that done. We'd appreciate it very much, Mr. Fitch.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Item number four, Fire Chief Guy Bonamp, Fire Protection District number one, to provide an update on the operations of the district. Chief, thank you for coming back.
Oh, no problem. And I'm going to use, let me not say it like that, LSU accident lady, Ms. Christie, is going to help us with this because I didn't recognize it.
Hey, good firefighters always have assistance, right?
We got them. We have volunteers all over the place. All right, again, my name is Guy Bonham. I'm actually the fire chief for Iberia Parish Fire District number one.
F8.
There we go. And for you that don't really understand, there's a lot of people don't understand how we function. I still have people daily that come up to me and ask us, why do we have two chiefs with one fire department? The city fire department and the parish fire department are two complete separate entities. The fire district is comprised of six parish departments and three municipalities, which is Generette, Delcombe, and Lorville. We have volunteers that actually respond with us also, along with our career department. The fire district has one career station that's on the corner of Avery Island Road at 2309. We have also since built an administrative office along with this station. We have a minimum of five firefighters and a maximum of seven. That does not include myself, my deputy chief, and our mechanic. And I know you're wondering why I said mechanic. My mechanic is also a certified firefighter and a retired chief from Richard. So if we get a major accident or a major fire, he's jumping in the vehicle with one of us and he's coming with us. We respond with multiple departments throughout the parish. We will never respond with just one. For instance, we go into Coto for a structure fire. We're going to have four responding departments coming with us with no less than probably 7 or 8 trucks. So we definitely have them moving. The career department that we have, we're made up of one chief. I have a deputy chief, the service technician, which is our mechanic, one secretary, 6 captains, and 15 firefighters. I also have a training officer that's going to start in November. He's going to come from offline. He will run our training facility, and that's where hopefully we'll use the additional people that we have in our budget to hire to make, which will give us 2 more captains and 3 more people. Our volunteers that we have are made up of battalion chiefs within their departments, and their rank structure is kind of dictated through their departments. We let the volunteer departments run their inner operations the way they need. They have their own ways. They've been running for a long time. We oversee firefighting operations and disciplines within of those operations for them. Each volunteer fireman has a voice-activated pager that they have to carry at all times. Well, we expect them to carry it all times. If we get a call, each department is going to be paged out to let them know that they're needed and to wait for the message that comes through. If you've been in restaurants, you've probably seen them get up and leave. Their family has seen them get up and leave from the table, get up in the middle of the night, leave for holidays. We could be gone for 10 minutes, we could be gone for 2 hours, we could be gone for 10 hours. We never know what we're going to get into. Volunteer firefighting is a lot more that goes into just running calls. Running calls is actually a fraction of what they actually do. They have their monthly meetings, we have fire board meetings, they have monthly and multiple trainings that they have to attend because they have to have a certain amount of hours of training to meet our fire insurance rating. Each department has work details because they do have trucks at their stations that they take pride in and stations they take pride in, and they have to keep those said units up. They have special duties that we have them doing within the stations just to keep the appearance up and to show the public that we do take care of the property that is actually bought by your tax money. The career and volunteer fire departments, we work hand in hand. We do all of our training together. Some training that the volunteer departments do, they do within their department, but we usually send one of our guys in there to give them a hand with it. A lot of our jobs and a lot of our work is interactive with each other because we need to know that if we have a fire, we have an extrication, or whatever it may be, that we can work hand in hand with each one of these people. We're going to run through some pictures. This is and it's different trucks that are set up. That was an aerial that's stationed at our station, at Station 100. BOM, this is actually one of their big heavy rescue trucks. That's a grass unit over in Coto. This is a tanker pumper out of Delcom. This is another tanker pumper out of Grand Mary. This is a pumper out of Generette. This is a pumper out of Lorville, and this is a small rescue truck out of Lydia. All of these departments, and this is actually another tanker out of Ronella, all of these departments have just about all of these trucks in their stations, except for the grass units. We only have 3 grass units through the parish, and we dispatch them out. When we tell people we cover 400 square miles of the parish, a number doesn't do it justice until you look at the map. The dark area is the city limits. Everything else is what we cover out of one station. And we work really hard getting to those departments. Those volunteer guys and girls come out to help us. We run structure fire, fire alarms, extrications, vehicle accidents, vehicle fire calls. We run medical calls, trash fires, grass fires, hazardous materials. We work a lot with Prescott Marshall and his group on the hazardous material side. We have technicians with our group and with the Sheriff's Department also. And we also do a lot of work assisting the Sheriff's Department. And a lot of people question why. Well, if there's a standoff somewhere, we're going to be there with our medical guys along with Acadian if they need help. Because Acadian can't always be there. So we're there, we assist them. Anything that the Sheriff's Department needs, we work hand-in-hand with them also. Our call breakdown from 2010, If you look at the calls, they pretty much stayed pretty steady. That 7.6 calls a day is spread out through the 365 days. I've seen us run 26 calls in a 24-hour span at the station, out of that one station. Our calls have come down a little bit, and we just it's just due to building materials a lot better and a lot of education. I've got a slide for that shortly. Respond to structure fires. We respond with manpower, water shuttle. We have the ability to flow 1,250 gallons a minute of water for 2 hours. We have to do it for our testing every 5 years. Most hydrants won't put out 1,000 gallons of water that you'll see on the streetways. And we flow 250 for 2 hours as a test. This is just some pictures of some fires we've had, a mobile home fire. Training, we have 3 district-wide trainings that we put on every month. When we get our training facility into place that y'all assisted us in acquiring the money for this, that's gonna jump up and people are just waiting to do training with us now. We're gonna have a first-class facility. We average, if you look up there, that is not a, the number's not wrong. It is 8,000 hours of training that we do yearly. And that's not counting the stuff that we just at the station, if they just go out and do some training with some of the rookies, we don't count those hours. Those are classroom hours or hands-on hours, 8,000 for the year. Different live evolutions. We'll get cars from some of the record yards, set them on fire, and teach our young ones how to get in there and put them out safely. LPG burns, we have tanks that LSU brings out for us, set them on fire and teach them how to get up to the tank and shut the valves off while it's still burning like you see it right there. House fire training, we acquire sometimes, it's getting a little bit harder now, but we can acquire homes that people want to get rid of and that are dilapidated, could be termite infested, don't have insurance on it, donated to us and they write off they don't have insurance. We have paperwork that our attorney previously had made sure was good enough for that, and we'll go in and hold a training. We can train setting these rooms on fire in these houses for probably about 7 hours of live fire training. We will go in there, set a room on fire, let the evolution run through, let the people get in there, see how it works, put it out, back out, and come in 2 minutes later and light it, and it will not be the same fire. And we do this as often as we can. It's just sometimes during the summer times we gotta take it easy. It does get a little warm. Our EMS response, we assist a Acadian ambulance. We run every single call that the parish, within the parish, that Acadian calls out to. It has picked up our call volume from about 800 to 900 calls in 08 to the 3,000 calls we run now. But when you ask the people of the lives that we've saved, if it's worth it, I'm sure they're not gonna have any argument. Our guys enjoy the work they do. A lot of people get to the station and where's everybody at? They're out, because we run. And I mean, 7 calls a day. Like I said, sometimes it's just the numbers kind of spread a little different, because today, I think today itself, we're already at 9. Community outreach is something that we went big into just because we were trying to slow our fires down. And we started going into the schools. We go to civics group, we do speaking. When we go out to the schools, we actually see every child from pre-K to the third grade in all our Berry Parish schools in October for Fire Prevention Week. We go to over 900 businesses a year to get updated information for those buildings. So if at night there's a fire, we can pull up this blueprint and we know where the hazardous material, if they have it, or where an office is, where a turn is in an office, to know how to maneuver through these buildings that we may not know because we're not in them beforehand. In 2010, that's when we put a more emphasis on our education. 2000 to 2009, we averaged 39 structure fires a year. And from 2010 to 14, we're down to 25 structure fires a year. It's a direct result of information that we're putting out, our fire prevention and building codes with Mr. John and them pushing and enforcing what we need to do. all of our career employees are mandated to have a minimum of 240 hours of training per year. Sad thing is, our volunteer guys and girls are not that far off being forced to have the exact same hours. That's a big part of what hurts our fire insurance rating. Because to tell someone that they have to spend 240 hours doing training when they have a job that they attend to, they have a family, they have kids, it's almost impossible. And that's the reason why I left that blank at the bottom, I guess, because I want everybody to understand that we're paid to do that so we can make those hours. These volunteers aren't. And they still struggle, but let me tell you, they put out every bit of effort they can to get those hours. Our awards we've picked up in the last couple years, our Louisiana State Firefighter Award, which is given through the Firemen's Association, we have received it in 2012, 13, and 15. We also received the Louisiana Fire Chiefs Association Award in 15 for act of valor that was given to our whole department for a save that we did last year. And also in 2015, LWCC gave us a Safest 70 Award, which is acknowledgement for outstanding performance in community work, public safety. And we want to thank the council, President Romero, and all of the council members for all the support y'all have always given us. And we're going to keep doing what we're doing. And I'll take questions from anybody.
Mr. Gonsolin?
Guy, when do you think the training center is going to be fully operational?
Okay, I just had a meeting yesterday, and they're telling me December 17th, either the 14th or the 17th, they should be complete.
So this year?
Yes, sir. Okay. And once they get it complete, we're going to get into it as soon as they can let us in. But December 17th, that's what we're working on.
And on another note, how many volunteers are you running in the parish, roughly?
We have,
I saw the number of firefighters, but just volunteers.
Yeah, we have 100 volunteers, about 70 active. The other ones, the other 30, are what we call service work. They'll come out, supply water, help us pull equipment and stuff like that. But our active people are the people that's going to get on scene, actually put air packs on. Not any less important to be the service people, but our active people are the people that I know that when I'm short with somebody, I can grab these people and use them.
Mr. Broussard?
This one. Yeah. Chief, if you can,
sir.
Roughly compared to most rural parishes, our fire insurance rating is better than most, partly because we have paid and volunteer. If you could just kind of touch base on how it affects how much people are actually paying in premiums because of what y'all do.
We're at a class five. We've been a class five actually since the district was built out 13 years ago. Because of the combination department, they count a volunteer. It takes three volunteers to give us one complete person on staff, which is ridiculous. But it is the way they count it. So if I have 21 people on a fire call volunteers, I'm only getting credit for seven. A huge part of our problem with our rating is my manpower and my coverage. Because I don't have all the people to put out all over. And it all boils down to money and hiring, and we're doing the best we can. I know the parish does the best we can, trying to make sure we got the money to do the things we need to do. And I think we're doing well. Like I said, we're a class five. There's not many departments that cover 400 square miles.
That's the point.
Yeah, set up with the departments the way we have them set up and cover three municipalities that we don't have control of the municipalities, but we give them money to supplement some of the issues that they may have equipment-wise. And those three municipalities can sometimes, and I'm not saying it does, but can sometimes hinder what we do and how we work. Because if they don't have enough people coming to a call from a department, then that's going to be a negative impact on the rating. And that sometimes it happens. It's the nature of the business of a volunteer. You know, you have, and I'm just going to throw Lorville out there. Lorville, and we've talked about it. Louisville doesn't have their volunteers that are on the department. I don't think a single one of them works in the village. I think actually the closest one may be the chief, who works right here at Sunshine Equipment at the John Deere place on Highway 31. So that's, and it's understandable. I mean, you can't sit at home as a volunteer and wait for the tones to get off and feed your family with air.
But compared to a lot of parishes in this state, our fire rating for insurance is a lot better than many rural parishes.
Yes, sir.
And they don't cover quite as much as we do. So y'all are
driving
the cost of insurance down compared to a lot of places.
We are trying, without a doubt.
Thank you. Mr. Fitch?
That was my question. Thank you. No problem. Good question.
Anyone else? Mr. Brown?
Chief.
Yes, sir.
When the training facility going to be completed, will the city of New Iberia
Yes, sir.
Can go over for the training?
Yes,
and
sir.
And will there be a cost for that?
I'm not going to charge them. No, not the city. The city does their training with us now. They come to our station. We bring LSU in. Their guys come in, and we train together. As a matter of fact, I spoke to the chief probably a month ago, and he was talking about he was going to be able to maneuver some people around that when we do the trainings out there, he'll be able to send crews. I offered him our support that if he has crews out there, I can hold some of mine back and cover the district right on the edges of the city limits and in the city. We go in there and help them when they need right now. If there's any issues that they have, they can call us and we're going to be there for them.
Okay.
But they're definitely going to be able to come and it's not going to cost them anything.
Anyone else? Thank you, Chief. Appreciate you being here.
Thank y'all.
Reports, finance and administrative action. Item number one, administration to provide a report regarding services and estimated costs for our private agency person to obtain rights of way for parish projects. Anyone from the administration here to present that? All right. We can maybe send a request to the next meeting.
Next meeting.
Moving along, item number two, administration to provide an update on the status of a grant for the Robert B. Green Memorial Building. Anyone from the administration to report on the Robert B. Green?
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Daniels?
If I may, we don't have any update. I received the email. I also requested that State Representative Terry Landry be here to speak on behalf of that. And the email said that because of conflict with his schedule, he could not be here. But also, there's been a lot of misconception in the community regarding that building. And if I may, I'd like to make a clarification.
Please.
Okay. For those who are not familiar with the building, a grant was submitted for the Robert B. Green Memorial Building. And when the grant was submitted, we received it after it was submitted. And I want to thank this council for supporting everything that's transpired for this grant. When we did receive the grant, it was submitted under the Robert B. Green Veteran Memorial Building. Well, that is not the correct name of the building. The name of the building is the Robert B. Green Recreation Center. And once we received the grant here, we noticed the incorrect name. So we took it upon ourselves as a council to go back and make that change. The council went back and did a correction, because if we would have received this money under the wrong name, we could have jeopardized future grant monies for Iberia Parish. So once that was done, we did a change order. Okay, we haven't heard anything since that. But I also want to make a point that this council as a group decided to, we got an engineer in, but as a group we decided rather than doing renovations, we decided to build a new building. And there's a lot of misconception in the community thinking that this project is not going to be done, that one individual is trying to stop the progress of this building. That's incorrect. This council as a whole voted to build a new building rather than do renovations. And that's the only thing I'd like to say.
All right. We can keep the request open for any updates from the administration.
Yes, please.
All right. Moving along. Reports, parish or other governmental agencies. Administration to provide monthly status report on all grant projects, all in accordance with resolution number 2012-217. Public Works reports. Public Works reports department, Public Works Department report for closed work orders dated September 14th through 18th, 21st through 25th, and September 28th through October 2nd, 2015. Any comments? Questions? Special business, executive session pursuant to Louisiana RS 461073 and 4217A10 regarding Iberian Medical Center's acquisition of Dotrieve Hospital. Mr. Brown?
I see that we have quite a few of board appointments. Rather than having them still on, I think we could go through that and the ones that want to leave after the appointment.
And then you're going in the executive session, or they're doing it in public?
You want to do it in public?
Yeah, so we're not going to the executive.
Oh, you don't?
Mr. Shealy?
I'm going to leave that up to Mr. Temple and them, but I think that they want to do, want to probably do it in public session.
Oh, it's not going in executive session?
Okay.
Good evening, Mr. Como and council members. Yes, sir, you're correct. We would like to provide an update on the recently announced acquisition of Dotrieve Hospital by Hospital Service District Number 1 of Iberia Parish, and we would like to do that in open session.
Could you just introduce and say your name for the record?
Yeah, I'm Parker Templeton, and I'm Chief Executive Officer of Iberia Medical Center, and I'm fortunate to have with me several members of our Board of Commissioners, Mr. Larry Henskins, Mr. Bert Sestia, Mr. David Groner, Mr. Ernest Wilson, and Mr. Frederick Bozo Metz. I also have with us our hospital's attorney, Mr. Nick Gotchesan, and two members of our executive team, Shane Myers, our chief operating officer, and Stephanie Kirk, our chief financial officer. So first off, I'd like to just say for the record that we have not completed a transaction with Dotrieve Hospital. All we've done is announced what they call a non-binding letter of intent. And that was signed earlier this month and provides our organization the opportunity to go through the appropriate due diligence, financial, clinical, operational, and cultural due diligence to determine if the acquisition is in everyone's best interest. So before I provide more of the details, I just wanted to touch on more of a national or global level on healthcare. And the changes that we're seeing here in our industry are like none other that we've seen before. This is being driven primarily by the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. And one of the changes we're seeing is a significant increase in the number of hospital partnerships. And these can vary from very loose clinical affiliations, like we recently announced this year with Lafayette General and Ochsner Health System, to an acquisition. And you may have read here recently Lafayette General. They've acquired a number of facilities in Acadiana, including Acadia General in Crowley, St. Martin Hospital in Brobridge, the Critical Access Hospital in Kaplan. And they've also participated in the state's efforts to move the public hospitals into private partnerships. They did that last year when they took over the operation of UHC. And similar models can be found across the state, including our state's largest hospital service district, West Jefferson Medical Center, recently selling their entire assets to another not-for-profit organization. So we're seeing a number of changes in the industry, again being driven by the Affordable Care Act. And these partnerships afford the organizations, of course, economies of scale, increase market share, which serves us very well when we negotiate with our payers. And it also allows us to access best practices. And those are all driving forces to IMC's interest in the great organization of Dotrieves Hospital. When I came on board as CEO a little over 2 years ago, we began an extensive strategic planning exercise, which included a deep dive into our master campus plan. And we discovered a number of strategic opportunities. And as you may know, we've experienced a tremendous amount of growth. Since 2008, our OR volume has jumped 45.6%. Our emergency room volume is up nearly 40% over the last 8 years. And just in this last year, we've seen our obstetrics and cardiology volume nearly double when Dotrieves closed those two respective units. And so we've been working through the plan and including the funding mechanism, as you know, when we issued the request for $22 million in bonds. And now we have this opportunity to maybe work our way into accomplishing what our goals and priorities were identified in those strategic planning through an acquisition and not having to build from the ground up. It certainly you know, would be our interest and plan to maintain services in both organizations and maintain the employment opportunities. There's an extreme shortage of healthcare professionals across our country, and so we don't see you know, significant or any job losses with the potential acquisition. We also believe it would be in the community's best interest to unify what's been divided for now 65 years and be able to enhance and expand and build a world-class healthcare system here in Iberia Parish. So the process is beginning with the discovery, which we're just a week in, where we're looking at the various financial and statistics and all of those things. And then once we complete the design, we move into the discovery, we move into the design, where we look at how do we integrate successfully and maintain the financial success and stability of Iberia Medical Center by bringing on the additional assets. And then the last phase, of course, would be the deployment. So discovery, design, deploy. And we expect the discovery and design phases to take us up through the end of the year. We've engaged the very best resources, a company based out of Atlanta, Georgia, called Dixon Hughes. And they work with hospitals all over the country to integrate services with these acquisitions. They do hundreds of these each year. We've engaged them. They'll be on site beginning Monday. We've also engaged a group out of Tampa, Florida, which will do the asset valuation component for us. And the expectation is for all this work to be completed, the due diligence phase ended up ending by the end of November, moving into an asset purchase agreement, and closing at the end of the year. So I know there's lots of questions. Unfortunately, at this stage, we really don't have all of the answers, or even many of the answers, but we certainly plan and expect to before moving into the next phases. Certainly, again, appreciate the opportunity to address you all this evening. I want to thank the board and my senior team for their vision as we've gotten to this point. We're very excited. The feedback that I've received throughout the community and especially within the organizations has been overwhelmingly positive. And once again, we look forward to creating a best-in-class healthcare system together here in Iberia Parish. So I'll stop there and be happy to entertain any questions.
Good luck.
Yes. Please keep us posted.
I know you'd rather not answer some of the others.
Maybe I'd rather, but unfortunately, I probably can't.
No. You want to answer? Wait, let me just ask.
Okay.
If we do buy Dewtree, will it, the name remain the same?
I haven't. We haven't gotten to that point yet. But I'll tell you, I mean, it is, it would be considered Hospital Service District number one. When we buy a CT scanner or build a new building, it is owned under the Hospital Service District entity. So we haven't figured out, what the name would be. There's certainly a rich history with the Dewtree family here in Iberia Parish, but it would become a Hospital Service District asset.
Parker, just keep us posted and just commend your efforts and lean on your board hard because you got a great board of directors.
Thank you. Sure do.
All right.
Thank you.
Appreciate you being here. Thanks to all. Everyone else attending, please keep us posted. Council member announcements.
Yes.
Ms. Arnold?
I made this announcement when we had our first committee meeting for the budget. I would like to thank all of you all for supporting the partnership with IDF and Francis Marion Boley STEM Ag Academy. It is with great pleasure that I announce that they were awarded a $110,000 grant. So thank you.
Congratulations. Anyone else? Ongoing information as it arises, I promise to keep you informed that as far as the BP settlement, St. Mary Parish did get in excess of $907,000. Sister Parish, right adjacent to Iberia Parish, we got zero because we didn't apply. Administration didn't see fit to apply, and St. Mary got a $907,000. Parish President announcements. Ms. Lestrade?
I just wanted to make y'all aware, I did present a report that was placed at y'all desk earlier this evening, showing the recap of all the funding and the loans that were made for Acadian Fairgrounds. I was asked to present this, so if y'all have any questions or anything, by all means, just let me know.
Mr. Brown?
About the $50,000. There was a question of where did that fund go? Could you tell us?
Are we going to do this now or when we get to that item on the agenda?
Yeah, we can wait too.
We could wait.
Okay. Yeah, this was something else. I was asked to present a recap of all loans.
I'm pondering here. I'd like to just maybe get consensus. I'd like to go into to the executive session now and take care of the legal matters. And we didn't do that just now in the special business, but we do have an expansion that I would like to maybe address now and go into the special business. Is there any objection to me addressing that right now?
I think it's a good idea.
All right. So we're going to offer, we have an expansion to the agenda to offer, and the item is to discuss and consider a motion to expand the agenda to discuss and consider the following object. Item, executive session pursuant to Louisiana RS 42172 regarding litigation in order to provide updates on the following proceedings Iberia Parish Government versus Shane Romero, Western District of Louisiana, civil number 14-2985, and B, Holly Lilla Thubron versus Iberia Parish Government, Western District of Louisiana, civil action number 613-CV852.
Move for public hearing.
Second.
Second.
Let me go ahead. Read this summary number three. Summary number 327, introduced by legal counsel. Resolution authorizing any recommended action regarding litigation entitled Iberia Parish Government versus Shane Romero, Western District of Louisiana, civil number 14-2985, and summary number 328, introduced by legal counsel. A resolution authorizing any recommended action regarding litigation entitled Iberia Parish Government versus Holly Lilla Thubron versus Iberia Parish Government. I'm not sure if that's a typographical. Western District of Louisiana civil action number 613-CV852. It should read Holly Lilla Thubron versus Iberia Parish Government. That's all right. And the purpose of this expansion is to allow legal counsel to provide an update on the above referenced litigation and adopt any recommended action regarding said litigation.
Move for public hearing.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Broussard and a second by Mr. Gonsalant to go into public hearing. Roll call. That motion carries. I need a motion to go into ask that anyone in the public here with us tonight would like to say anything about the items I just read in reference to those two lawsuits and the expansion of the agenda tonight. Anyone, this is your time to speak if you'd like to address any one of these issues and the expansion of the agenda for us to discuss those issues in executive session. Hearing none.
Move
by Mr. Broussard. Second by Mr. Fitch to go back into regular session. Roll call. That motion carries.
Motion for the expansion.
Second.
We have a motion by Mr. Broussard and second by Mr. Ditch to on the expansion. Roll call. That motion carries unanimously. Okay, so that by the passing of that motion, we are now in executive session. So we'd ask the general public to please step out for a few minutes and give us an opportunity to address these issues.
Motion that we go back into regular session.
Motion by Mr. Broussard to go in regular session by Mr. Wayne Romero. Roll call. That motion carries. We will, as the expansion addressed these two different motions, item summary number 327, a resolution authorizing any recommended action regarding litigation entitled Iberia Parish Government versus Shane Romero, Western District of Louisiana, civil number 14-2985. Mr. McGoffin, would you care to read the full resolution as it's written?
Yes, sir. Resolution number 2015-327, a resolution to approve settlement of the federal lawsuit filed by the Iberia Parish Government versus Shane Romero, bearing civil action number 6:14-CV-2985, United States District Court, Western District of Louisiana, Lafayette Division. Whereas the Iberia Parish Government filed a complaint for injunctive relief against Shane Romero in civil action number 6:14-CV-2985 in the United States District Court, Western District, Lafayette Division, and whereas the defendant in that action has signed the settlement agreement, and whereas the settlement agreement includes a mutual release of all claims asserted by the Iberia Parish Government and Shane Romero, together with all claims asserted by the plaintiff Holly Lilla Thubron in that lawsuit entitled Holly Lilla Thubron versus Iberia Parish Government, filed in the United States District Court for the Western District, Lafayette Division, as civil action number 6:13-CV-852. And whereas the total amount to be paid by Iberia Parish Government to Holly LaLuth Thubren is $50,000, of which $39,000 shall be paid by Iberia Parish Government, and $11,000 shall be contributed by Shane Romero from the fee claim that he may have against Iberia Parish Government in the lawsuit entitled Iberia Parish Government versus Shane Romero, filed in the United States District Court for the Western District, Lafayette Division, as civil action 6:14-CV-2985. And whereas the settlement agreement includes mutual releases for all parties in both actions, and whereas the cost of continued litigation and the trial of these matters far exceeds the amounts to be paid for the settlement of this strongly disputed claim, and in no way constitutes an admission of wrongdoing by the Iberia Parish Government, its counsel, or the individual council member defendants. And whereas time is of the essence in concluding these matters, this resolution shall become effective immediately upon adoption by the Iberia Parish Council and approval by the parish president in accordance with section 2-13 of the Iberia Parish Home Rule Charter. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Iberia Parish Council hereby authorizes its chairman, Troy Como, to conclude the settlement of any and all claims by Iberia Parish Government and by Shane Romero, and to execute any and all documents necessary to conclude this settlement and to dismiss the federal lawsuit. And be it further resolved that this resolution shall become effective immediately upon adoption by the Iberia Parish Council and approval by the parish president in accordance with section 2-13 of the Iberia Parish Home Rule Charter.
I would ask that we actually go back into public hearing on this matter. So I'll make a motion that we go into public hearing.
I'll second it.
I have a motion by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Gonsalant, that we go into public hearing. Roll call. That motion carries. We're now in public hearing, so we'd like to offer the opportunity to anyone in the public who would like to comment about this settlement that was just read in the lawsuit injunction. Iberia Parish Government versus Shane Romero. Anyone here tonight like to make comments? This is your time to speak.
I'll ask that we go back into regular session.
Hearing none, we have a motion to go back into regular session by Mr. Broussard.
Section.
Second by Mr. Brown. Roll call. That motion carries. We're now in regular session.
I'll move that we accept the settlement.
Second. Motion by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Ditch, that we accept. Adopt the resolution 327 as it regards to the settlement. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Resolution number 328, introduced by legal counsel, a resolution authorizing any recommended action regarding litigation entitled Holly LaLuth Thubren versus Iberia Parish Government, Western District of Louisiana, civil action number 6:13-CV-852. Mr. McGoffin, would you care to read the the record the entire resolution?
Yes, sir. Resolution number 2015-328, a resolution to approve settlement of the federal lawsuit filed by Holly LaLuth Thubren against the Iberia Parish Government, its council, and eight council members, bearing civil action number 6:13-CV-852, United States District Court, Western District of Louisiana, Lafayette Division. Whereas the Iberia Parish Government, the Iberia Parish Council, and eight of the Iberia Parish Council members have been named as defendants in that lawsuit entitled Holly LaLuth Thubren versus Iberia Parish Government et al., filed in the United States District Court for the Western District as civil action number 6:13-CV-852, and whereas the plaintiff in that action has agreed to settle all civil claims pursuant to the terms of the settlement agreement, and whereas the settlement agreement includes a mutual release of all claims asserted by the plaintiff, Holly LaLuth Thubren, along with all claims pending between Iberia Parish Government and its lawsuit against Shane Romero, and that lawsuit entitled Iberia Parish Government versus Shane Romero, filed in the United States District Court for the Western District, Lafayette Division, as civil action number 6:14-CV-2985. And whereas the total amount to be paid by Iberia Parish Government to Holly LaLuth Thubren is $50,000, of which $39,000 shall be paid by Iberia Parish Government, and $11,000 shall be contributed by Shane Romero from the fee claim he has against Iberia Parish Government in the lawsuit entitled Iberia Parish Government versus Shane Romero, filed in the United States District Court for the Western District, Lafayette Division, as civil action number 6:14-CV-2985. And whereas the settlement agreement includes mutual releases for all parties, and whereas the cost of continued litigation and the trial of these matters far exceeds the amounts to be paid for the settlement of this strongly disputed claim, and in no way constitutes an admission of wrongdoing by the Iberia Parish Government, its council, or the individual council member defendants. And whereas time is of the essence in concluding these matters, this resolution shall become effective immediately upon adoption by the Iberia Parish Council and approval by the parish president in accordance with section 2-13 of the Iberia Parish Home Rule Charter. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Iberia Parish Council hereby authorizes its chairman, Troy Como, to conclude the settlement of the Holly LaLuth Thubren lawsuit by payment of the sum of $50,000, comprised of $39,000 from Iberia Parish Government and $11,000 which may be due to Shane Romero, pursuant to judgment in that action, and to execute any and all documents necessary to conclude this settlement and to dismiss that federal lawsuit. And be it further resolved that this resolution shall become effective immediately upon adoption by the Iberia Parish Council and approval by the Iberia Parish President in accordance with section 2-13 of the Iberia Parish Home Rule Charter.
Mr. Chairman, I'll ask that we go into a public hearing on resolution number 2015-328.
Second.
We have a motion by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Gonsolin to go into a public hearing. Roll call. That motion carries. We're now in public hearing. Anyone here in the general public tonight like to comment or speak to this resolution number 328 as it pertains to the settlement of the lawsuit? This is your time to speak. Hearing none.
I'll act that we go back into regular session.
Move by Mr. Broussard to go back into regular session.
Second.
Second by Mr. Davis. Roll call. That motion carries. We're now in regular session.
I'll make a motion that we adopt summary number 328.
Summary number 328 moved by Mr. Broussard. Second by Mr. Romero. Wayne Romero. Discussion. Just for the record, we want to say that this is the same $50,000. It's not two sets of $50,000. It's the same settlement, one settlement, two different documents pertaining to.
That is correct.
Just for the record. Roll call. That motion carried. So we have a couple of three more signatures that need to be had on the documents, and they'll be entered into the record, into the minutes as a public document.
We removed the reference to it being attached to the resolution.
Correct.
And so once we have the resolution back, it will be in the parish records, and it will be a matter of public record at that
right.
point.
Okay.
Do you need these resolutions?
You're free to have those.
Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Mr. Fitch.
I would like to thank Mr. Dewey, publicly thank Mr. Dewey, Mr. McGoffin for their work on this these issues. Next council that takes office won't have to deal with this and hopefully never has to deal with anything like this again. They did an outstanding job of representing Iberia Parish Government and the council members who were sued. And as this document states, this does not admit guilt. It's just the cost of litigation far exceeds the settlement offer. And they did a great job, and I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And if I may, I appreciate the fact that this council has accepted our recommendation, Mr. McGoffin and mine, through the district attorney's office. Realizing that the economics of this and the cost to the taxpayers in the parish would far exceed continuing to trial than the $50,000 total payment that was made, and it's a strictly an economic decision, as you acknowledge, Mr. Fitch, and I appreciate y'all's consideration for that. I think this is an opportunity to move this parish forward, which we're all looking forward to.
Anyone else?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Allow for a motion that we go into public comment.
Move.
We have a motion by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Ditch, to go into public hearing for the remainder of the agenda. Comments to the remainder of the agenda. Roll call. That motion carries. Anyone in the general public have anything to say about any other item on the agenda that we haven't covered yet? Ordinances or resolutions, this is your turn to speak. Please join us at the podium, state your name for the record, and your address, please.
Good evening. My name is Randy Gosselin, 408 Estate Drive, near Iberia. I'm speaking to you as chairman of Iberia Parish Airport Authority and want to address summary number 308, appointment of Iberia Parish Airport Commission. This appointment will fill the oncoming vacancy that would be created by Mrs. Wendy Eldridge on October 28th. Mrs. Eldridge was literally our eyes at the airport, and as a supervisor of the control tower, she had viewed and had firsthand knowledge of air and ground traffic of all types of aircraft, and was made aware of what issues that cropped up on the taxiways, ramps, obstructions that needed to be addressed for the benefit of all aircraft, including fixed wings, float planes, and rotorcraft, comprised of private, corporate, and military entering the airspace. She brought to the commission a unique perspective of what actually went on at Acadiana Regional Airport, which will be very, very hard to match. However, it has come to a point where a replacement has to be chosen from those that have agreed to volunteer their time and share their expertise in overseeing the management of two airports owned by Iberia Parish taxpayers through its director, Mr. Jason DeValier, which are more commonly known as Lemaire Memorial Airport and Acadiana Regional Airport. Combined, both airports occupy in excess of 2,000 acres of land and consist of 38 tenants with approximately 50 aircraft, fixed-winged and rotorcraft, housed in hangar facilities, providing in excess of $1.4 million in rental income, making ARA self-sustaining, as well as generating approximately $1.2 million in property tax that is paid directly to Iberia Parish government by its tenants. That being said, the responsibility of making the right decision as a whole and maintaining professional relationships where proper respect is maintained between commissioners is paramount. On October 13, 2015, at a regular meeting of the Iberia Parish Airport Authority, and at my request, three of the five applicants addressed the authority and were asked as to what each of them could bring to the table to assist and improve the outlook on such an asset, again owned by the taxpayers. Mr. David Lamb informed us of his legal background and his desire to get involved. Mr. Jared Landry expressed his interest in becoming part of IPAA with new ideas and his indirect association with AVEX. Mr. Gerald Fork offered his assistance through his association with One Acadiana and IDF, as well as contacts through all of the associations and organizations that he was and is still part of. Mr. Carl Vences had other obligations and was not able to attend. Mr. Tom LeBlanc was out of the country, but having prior engineering experience, a pilot and part owner of Service Tool Company, with direct contacts to FedEx and other freight haulers, he has an opportunity to possibly provide an added benefit in the way of marketing and recruiting strategies related to freight haulers. Upon adjournment of the meeting, I pulled the officers and commissioners present for that meeting and simply asked if you were a stockholder or director of a similar entity that we presently serve on, which two applicants would you call back for a second interview to become part of a management team? The response was as follows. Of the 10 votes, Tom LeBlanc, 4 votes. Or of the 10 opinions, 4 votes was Mr. Tom LeBlanc Jr., 4 votes was Mr. Gerald Falk, 2 votes for Mr. Jared Landry. There were no other votes cast. Having said that, I am requesting the Iberia Parish Council, the entity that appointed each of the present commissioners, to consider the info presented and select one of the two individuals noted above having the highest ranking to fill the oncoming vacancy and serve alongside the team that you as councilman have appointed over the past years based on the added benefit we, the present commissioners, have brought to the table. Thank you for your attention. Any questions?
Any questions? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hi, Eugene Olivier, President of Water Works District Number 4, Summary 307, a resolution appointing Ms. Mary Babineau to Water Works District Number 4. Mary was here earlier, if you might have seen her. She apologized for she couldn't stay. She has some prior appointments, but she appreciates your appointment to the district. Thank you.
Carl Vincent, volunteer at the Acadiana Fairgrounds. You know, I've been helping as a volunteer, and I speak to you strictly as a volunteer tonight with budgets and usual stuff, and serving over there almost 14 and a half years, 5 or 6 as chairman and 12 as finance director. I think I was probably more upset than the current chairman when he got an email saying you had $175,000 in your RVR account, Carol. We took back 50 for the loan. In 14 and a half years, that has never happened without a resolution from a commission. And I can imagine any board or commission member serving here knows that just doesn't happen. I don't know why it did. What I would hope is that y'all get answers, because really and truly, it doesn't matter if it went back into royalty to pay a loan. They were organizing money to pay bond note. That was their goal. And I know this just because I helped do the budget. I'm a volunteer. Carol didn't ask me to talk. Probably doesn't want me to talk. But the point is that just doesn't happen. I filed the Freedom of Information request, and I got about 624 pages. And the stuff I saw from the CFO injecting her management of an independent commission for the last God knows how long, it upset me. There are guidelines. That's why these boards are set up, to take politics out. For some reason, they creep back in starting around Labor Day last year. I hope somebody can maybe have a meeting of the minds with the fourth floor and make them understand the Acadiana Fairgrounds is not a department of this fourth floor. It's an independent commission run by y'all, appointed by y'all commissioners. I would hope you guys would get that money directed back to the account the way it's supposed to be, so they can make plans to make another bond payment, because that was their goal. I know that. I just did the budget. I think I'm right, Carol. and someone should, I would hope y'all would find out who directed Ms. Bobette to do that, because that's a bold move. They pay for the accounting. They pay the fourth floor to account. That's all, just account. It's not, Ms. Bobette's not there, CFO's not there to tell them they can hire a band, not hire a band. That's between them and y'all. So please, get a handle on this now, because pretty soon you're not going to have anybody left to serve on that thing. Thank you.
How much is the bond payment, Mr. Vincent? How much is the bond payment that they're preparing?
For the year, y'all paid in June and July about $300 and something. Then there's another $75 coming due in November, okay? They directed $100, and they have, when they get, they're waiting on $104,000 from the Visitors Enterprise Fund. They got $155,000 roughly allocated. They funded about $40,000-$45,000 for the Sugar Arena to come up here. So when the Visitors Enterprise Fund money comes, and that's any day now, the Sugar Arena will pay them the $40 back. They've got a good, pretty good cash account. If they put the $50 back, they can pay another $100 right now, I believe, huh, Carol?
Yes.
I don't want to talk out of turn. Carol's a nice guy. I'm not so nice. I mean, this stuff upsets me, you know. But the money he's got in that place for 15 years and others, and the blood and the sweat to make it work, people don't understand. That place covered $7 million of its own operating expenses. That's figured out. I did the budgets. That's pretty doggone good. This parish is out of their pocket before the RVR was built, a total of less than $300,000 total. And for that, they got about $17 million of assets. What a deal, man. Thanks.
Anyone else? Anything, anyone else want to speak to the agenda? Moved by Mr. Brown. Second by Mr. Broussard to go back into regular session. Roll call. Somebody. So we're waiting on somebody to vote. Nope. Okay. Mr. Mayor.
There you go.
All right, we're now in regular session.
Oh, we're holding on this.
There's two empties. Tommy and Marty.
Sorry?
Yeah, got it. That motion carries. We're now in regular session. Summary number 4697, introduced by the Zoning Commission. An ordinance amending the Iberia Parish Zoning Ordinance to approve the zoning reclassification of the property of Afficionado. LLC from the current classification, of commercial neighborhood business C1 to commercial general business C2, except lot 1C of the Afficionado LLC plat located from the 2300 to 2800 block of Highway 675 Jefferson Island Road, located at District 2. And all as reviewed and approved by the Iberia Parish Regional Zoning Commission.
Move, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Move by Mr. Davis. Second by Mr. Fitch. Mr. Raines?
I have a map for you. I haven't hooked up my computer yet. And it's on 675. The lot that is being exempted out has access onto Wander Street, which is catty-corner from the school, and the rationale behind the difference in the zoning classification was just to leave it as is and do the frontage for the general commercial. We had the public hearing. There were several people in attendance, and everyone was in support of the change. There was no opposition whatsoever, and we would recommend approval as per the Zoning Commission. And I have learned the correct pronunciation is Afficionado.
Obviously, we should have met before the meeting, Mr. Or could I just let you read it?
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Raines. Any questions for Mr. Raines? Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 4698, introduced by the Planning Commission. An ordinance granting preliminary and final approval of the
Afficionado
subdivision, phase one, five lots on the Afficionado LLC property located on Jefferson Island Road, located in District 2, all as recommended by the Iberia Parish Regional Planning Commission.
Move
by Mr. Davis. Second by Mr. Glenn Romero. Discussion.
This is basically the same flat. This just shows in great order the same detail. And it does subdivide the property. And I do believe Brenda has gotten revised plats. And if we have to, we'll make some more corrections tomorrow morning. But everyone is in agreement. Once again, public hearing was conducted. Plenty of people came and asked questions. No one was in opposition. It was just smooth as glass.
Comments? Questions? Roll call. That motion carries. Resolutions introduced for public hearing and adoption to be voted on at tonight's meeting. Summary number 301, introduced by the Clerk of the Council. A resolution endorsing the application of Olympic Cranes and Fabrication, Inc. for the Louisiana Enterprise Zone.
Move
by Mr. Ditch.
Second.
Second by Mr. Fitch. Discussion.
The attachments included all the information was necessary. The only question is it within the TIF district, and did you want to exempt the TIF tax from that?
It is in the TIF district.
It's been the general consensus as to date that we do not exempt the TIF taxes as those businesses in the TIF reap the benefits of the the improvements in the district. Is that okay with your second?
Yes, sir.
Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 302, introduced by the parish president. A resolution granting substantial completion to build to the building 91 parking lot addition, all as completed by JC Construction LLC and as recommended by project engineer Paul J. Ollie.
Move
by Mr. Gosselin.
Second.
Second by Mr. Fitch. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 303, introduced by the parish president. A resolution granting substantial completion to the HMGP hardening of Acadiana Regional Airport Fire Station Building and Air Traffic Control Tower, all as completed by the Acadiana Renovations LTD and as recommended by project engineers, the Sellers Group.
Move
by Mr. Broussard.
Second.
Second by Mr. Ditch. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 304, introduced by the Clerk of the Council, a resolution appointing Mr. Larry Hinskins to the Iberia Parish Hospital District Service District Number 1 for a four-year term to fill a vacancy created by the expiration of term for Mr. Larry Hinskins, whose term expires on December 27, 2015.
Move
by Ms. Daniels, second by Mr. Ditch. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Hinskins, for all you do.
And for sitting here.
If it wouldn't be such a late hour, I would tell the story. That,
oh, no, sorry.
But since Mr. Hinskins is in my district, so I.
Any job gets tough.
And we've had some leave conversations about volunteering. Yes.
Leave it for Mr. Metz, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, absolutely. That motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Hinskins. Summary number 305, introduced by the Clerk of the Council, a resolution appointing Mr. Frederick G. Metz, Jr. to the Iberia Parish Hospital District, Service District, Number 1, for a four-year term to fill a vacancy created by the expiration of term for Mr. Frederick D. G. Metz, Jr., whose term expires on December 27, 2015. Moved by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Gosselin. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Metz, for your time you served. Summary
just
number
you asked for.
That's right. Summary number 306, introduced by the Clerk of the Council, a resolution appointing Mr. Burton E. Sestia, Jr. to the Iberia Parish Hospital Service District Number 1 for a four-year term to fill a vacancy created by the expiration of term for Mr. Burton E. Sestia, Jr., whose term expires on November 23rd, 2015.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Davis, second by Mr. Ditch. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Sester. Thank you. It's good to see the team staying together to follow up on the
big decisions in the future.
Yes, what's coming ahead with the hospital district. Summary number 307, introduced by the Clerk of the Council, a resolution appointing Mrs. Mary S. Bavano. A resolution appointing Mrs. Mary S. Bavano to the Waterworks District Number 4 Board for the remainder of a five-year term to fill a vacancy created by the resignation of Ms. Donna Gravois, whose term expires on June 12, 2017.
Move
by Mr. Duncan. Second by Ms. Daniels. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 308, introduced by the Clerk of the Council, a resolution appointing one member to the Iberia Parish Airport Authority for a five-year term to fill a vacancy created by the expiration of term for Mrs. Wendy Carr Elridge, whose term expires on October 28, 2015. Applications of interest on file from A. Jarrett Landry, B. Carl Vincent, C. Gerald Falk, D. Thomas LeBlanc, Jr., and E. David Lamb.
Move the table.
Is there a reason why, Mr. Brown, that you want to take?
Because of two vacancies here.
The chair is not going to entertain the table. We'll go ahead and I'll call for the vote. If we don't get eight, I'll entertain the table at a later.
You don't entertain the table?
No, sir. I'm not entertaining the table. Cast your ballots.
Hey, Mr. Shealy, can you not entertain a second? Can you refuse a second?
Your motion is to table.
Yeah, and I got a second.
Come on, that motion's gonna at least to be voted on. There's a motion, there's a second. I think that you need to vote on whether or not it should be tabled. If it fails, then you move on with your votes like you planned to.
I stand corrected. I'm gonna just go ahead and comp before I accept the second. I think it's irresponsible. These people have been waiting. We have no idea if we're gonna get 8 votes or not to table it in advance of having a vote. We've tabled them in the past when people have requested not to go into multiple votes after votes after votes until we got some more people here. But we have no idea that that's gonna take place tonight. So to me, there's another motive, and I think the people deserve to know the truth as I see it. So that was my intention, was to see the vote take place. But I stand corrected, and I appreciate you being here, Mr. Shealy, to set me straight. But I won't go without saying that I think there's another motive, and I think that the next meeting will be after the election.
Ms. Carr, what was the
reason? I didn't accept the second, Mr. Duncan.
What's the reason she's not coming back for another term? Is she termed out?
No, she's resigning.
She resigned?
No, I'm sorry. She did not express interest to be. Her term is up on October 28th. So we have a motion by Mr. Brown to table, and the second came from Mr. Davis. On the table. That motion.
Tabled.
That item has been tabled. Summary number 309, introduced by the clerk of the council, a resolution appointing Mr. Lucas Stelly to the Twin Parish Port Commission for a 5-year term to fill a vacancy created by the expiration of term for Mr. Lucas Stelly, whose term expires on November 8, 2015. Moved by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Ms. Arnold. Discussion. Roll call. That motion, were you missing somebody?
Then you voted?
Yeah.
Okay.
It might have been.
Maybe not, but it's just.
That motion carries. Mr. Stelly with us? No? We appreciate his service as well. Summary number 310, introduced by the clerk of the council, a resolution appointing Mr. Tracy J. Miguez to the Iberia Parish, Sewer District Number 1 Board for a 5-year term to fill a vacancy created by the expiration of term for Mr. Tracy J. Miguez.
Moved
by Mr. Romero.
Second.
Wayne Romero, second by Mr. Glenn Romero. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Is Mr. Miguez here? We'll send our gratitude to Mr. Miguez for his service. Summary number 311, introduced by Bernard E. Broussard, District 6, a resolution create an economic development district for property located at 2919 West Spanish Trail, owned by Community First Bank.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Davis. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 312, introduced by Bernard E. Broussard, District 6, a resolution requesting a status update on a request from the Acadiana Fairgrounds Commission to return funding to a particular line item based on a request from the commission.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Brown. Discussion.
I guess the question is, did the commission ask that those monies be moved?
No. Based on the resolution that authorized the funding of those loans, the funds were supposed to be reimbursed each day as they make deposits.
Go back and read it, because it also says in there that those funds are to be first paid off on the bonds. And after those bonds have been paid, then any other debt. So that was, am I correct?
If you could bear with me a minute.
Is 149? Is that the resolution? I have it here.
I didn't see that in that resolution.
I understand, but the resolution says, it's the same resolution that I made before for the airport and others, where there was cash flow shortages, that the bond should be paid before any other thing that's paid. And that verbiage should be at the bottom of that one.
Ms. Lestrap, do you have the resolution?
This is what I'm going by, is the resolution and the discussion that was discussed at the December, I believe, 17th meeting. If I could play that.
Please.
Discussion.
No. You have to start it over, Ms. Lestrap?
Yeah, start it over. I'm not sure where the speaker is on this one.
Make sure that everything processes in accordance with the big debt box, that money is automatically just in a time, move back to the head of the fund.
Basically, what Mr. Broussard is saying is that when the money is deposited, the funds would be moved back into the fund when they make their deposits.
Do you know what resolution that number is?
Yes, that was the first one that y'all adopted. It was 214-460, I believe it was, when you gave them the first $50,000.
460.
214-460.
If I'm not mistaken, though, you told clerk 2014-149 was the resolution that you're using, and that does say that the bond payments are to be the first one to be paid.
She was asking about 2014-149. I was clarifying to her that was resolution stated that when the for that particular resolution, which was done way in advance of these came after, that the funds would be reimbursed when the revenues hit 100,000. At that time, they had over 170 plus thousand in the bank, but while they had that in the bank, their net profits were not over 100,000. That is explaining to the clerk that resolution, not the resolution that to repay the operating loan. Resolution 2014-460 is the one that granted them the operating loan. What was the $50,000 went to reimburse the royalty fund for the operating loans in accordance with the resolution that it was passed with and the discussion from you, Mr. Broussard, at the December 17th meeting. If I could play it, I'd be happy to play it, but I don't believe y'all can hear it.
Part of the question I asked is what fund, and we never got that answer. So you tell
and
me.
I apologize for that. I was out of town. The administration, well, legal, they were all fully aware of the situation.
Because that's been going on for weeks.
It went to royalty fund. It went to pay the operating loan, as stated.
So the entire transfer went to royalty?
Yes, sir.
Is Mr. Brown?
My bad. You said that was a resolution. Did Mr. Romero sign that resolution?
Yes, sir.
He did.
Yes, it was initiated by Mr. Benoit Broussard and passed by the council. Mr. Romero did sign that resolution, to my knowledge. He didn't veto it.
No,
it's in the minutes of that meeting.
The resolution that she's gone by.
Yeah.
She said it was a resolution.
Resolution 2014-460.
He approved it? Did Mr. Romero approve that resolution?
He must have. The copy that I've provided is the one signed by the clerk. It was adopted December 17th, 2014.
Part of the question is what point?
You got your hand?
So, what it...
The majority of the council members voted in favor of this resolution. There were two nays and two absentees and one abstain.
You got that?
So the funds were put back into the royalty?
Yes, sir.
And your definition is to, the purpose is to repay the loan?
Repay that operating loan. I know the intent, the full intent of this is to repay that operating loan each time they make a deposit, but that is just too cumbersome for my department to do that and for us to do that. So instead of repaying the loan and then having to turn around and loan them the money right back in a couple of days, we did not do that. We only did this at this particular time because they had a large amount of funds in their account. It was sufficient enough to pay down that operating loan a little bit. The balance in the checking account at the time was over $170,000. It left sufficient funds for them to pay the sewer impact fees should they decide to pay their sewer impact fees and to pay for any other tax liabilities that they have incurred.
In that, the loan, is that cover previous bond issues?
No.
Bond payments?
This is the operating loan. This is not the loans for the bond payments. Okay. That's the separate loans. And if you look at the schedule I provided y'all earlier this evening, those resolutions are on that, and that's shown on that schedule. Nothing has been paid back for the bond payments. Bond payments for 2015 have already been made. The general fund paid them, or loaned the money to pay them.
And the grand total to that is, as to date, that's today's date, $8,806,956.20. That's the balance sheet?
That's the total, not necessarily the balance sheet. Some of this is operating expenditures.
So it's just
that's the total.
It's labeled a recap
funding.
Of funding. Okay.
Right, for that facility. So for to date.
I got a question.
Mr. Brown?
I'm wondering if the fairground had any other activity that they had planned with this money. Was this discussed?
That I do not know. You'd have to ask the Fairground Commission, but based on this council's intent and what was discussed at that meeting is that it was to initially go for essential operating expenses, meaning salaries and insurance. Y'all later amended that resolution to pretty much let them use it for entertainment, Cajun Hot Sauce Festival, pretty much anything they needed. But the payment terms were never changed. So the payment terms is as their monies come in, they are to pay down their operating loan.
What the payment terms?
Oh, say you pay the bonds first. I'm not looking at the resolution.
Mr. Gonsolet?
My bad, just for clarifications, how many bond payments did the Acadiana Fairgrounds make so far?
Bond payments made on behalf of Acadiana Fairgrounds was 3.
Okay.
3 complete bond payments?
Paid by the...
Made on behalf. General funds paid those.
Yeah, but that's what I'm asking you. The general fund payment, I'm saying, how many did they initiate to pay on bond pay, the Acadiana Fairgrounds? How many dollars did he contribute to the bond payments?
None.
That would be 0, right?
Correct.
Okay.
The bond payment, that's 2 in... That's 3. A payment and an interest payment.
Right. So a year and a half.
Right.
Worth of
total
year,
debt
a
service.
Year and a half.
Total debt service to date is a little over $1.1 million.
A year and
principal
a half.
Principal plus interest.
Correct.
No, the bonds were issued in 2012, so it's 3 years.
Okay.
of interest, and I think we've only made like three principal payments, but 3 years of interest.
On 149, though, the line of credit's still open.
Correct.
You paid it down.
Paid it down. If they need it.
They can draw on 149.
They do not have to go back to the council to request the funding. The funding's still in place.
And it's been paid back to the royalty, but it is now another open line of credit if needed on that one.
Right.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Ditch?
No, I'm good for now.
Yeah, I just want to make sure we can pay for the funding, and they never had to go to none of the.
Mr. Gonsalas?
My bad. Just in previous in finance committee meetings, you said the general fund was under some extreme pressure moving forward. Is this any way contributing to what's happening to the general fund?
By all means.
It is?
Yes. If you look at how much the general fund has loaned, the commission is over 2.8 million.
2.8 million. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Ditch?
Yeah, I think, you know, the intention of that resolution was, you know, we can talk about how it was a different intention now. I mean, that was a couple of years ago. I think everybody's intention was to have those funds paid back as soon as possible. But I think what's more important now is just setting a precedent with the commissions. So y'all on the same board. I spoke to Mr. Boudreaux about it. Just so we know, you know, if it is the intent and legal agrees that they need to come to you with a resolution before we move money in this capacity, I think it just needs to be a black and white issue, you know, going forward. So let's just address it, get together with them, so it doesn't happen again the next time we have excess funds. So it's all done. So we don't have to come back and fight this issue. I mean, this is an issue that happened in the past. I think it corrected now, which is good. But let's just get a black and white answer. Do you have the authority to move the money or not without any commission's approval? Get that answer from the district attorney and move forward and just come to a resolution where they pass the resolution prior to. Because I think their intent was the same, to pay the bond payments back. As Mr. Vincent stated, it was just the way it was done, I think, is what caused the problem. Let's just get it fixed so we don't have to deal with this again.
That's fine, but then this resolution needs to be rescinded and the terms need to be changed. Which one?
But I think the intent of that resolution still stands, and I think it's just the actual, the resolution should be coming from the Sugar Arena Commission to you to pay that money back. I think it would just, if that's how it's always been done and that's how it needs to be done, then let's just follow it. If not, change.
It's never been done.
Can you
paid any money back.
No, I understand that. But in the past, how it's been done, at least how I'm just taking their word for how it's done with other commissions, in the administrative process, I don't think we move money for commissions as administrative tasks. Let's just get clarification on that so we know how it's moved in the future so we don't have these questions.
Right. And I think from an audit standpoint, and to make sure that everything is clear and above board, we need to modify or rescind this resolution 2014-460 because it is stated in there that is that the Director of Finance is authorized to make those transfers, but that resolution needs to be rescinded and a new resolution needs to be drafted to accommodate however you would like it to do.
So your resolution you read and states that the finance officer has the authority to move that money without approval of the commission.
It does not state that it requires approval of anyone.
But it states that you have the authority to move it in the resolution?
Yes. All upon the approval of the Director of Finance, quote unquote.
I got a question.
If I can.
Well, but to me, upon the approval of the Director of Finance is different than with the discretion of the Chief. And that's just a clarification I think we need from legal for all the boards and commissions, if we can get it.
Be it further resolved that said funding shall be reimbursed to the royalty fund budget as soon as deposits are made into the Acadiana Fairgrounds Commission's accounts through transfer of funds initiated by the Director of Finance. That is stated in the resolution.
Okay.
So if this isn't the intent of the resolution, that's fine. We just need to change this resolution. Yeah.
Okay. If I can, I want to clarify 312. 312 was what fund was it paid to, because there's been some questions over the last few weeks. Money was extracted, what fund did it go into? This is the first I hear of it. You've answered the question that I've asked. That's part of the question I've been trying to get is, what fund did it pay?
It went back to pay the royalty fund. I'm not authorized to make transfers to pay back the debt, all the bond payments. I'm only authorized to pay down the operating loans.
Understood, but.
And I'm also authorized to extend them to give them additional funds if needed up to the funding
understood
cap
that
y'all
the reason
that
the resolution is, it's been asked for weeks. It hasn't been answered for whatever reason. you've answered the question, and I thank you for that.
Before we move on, can you answer a question for me, what the difference between a loan and an operating loan is?
Same thing.
Okay. Oh, I can answer the question you're asking, Charles.
All right. I would agree, with Mr. Ostrowski, we definitely need to clear it up, because 149 and 460, the language is different, and that's where the, I think some of the confusion looks to me to be coming from, so you probably need to straighten that out.
I understand that. I'm all right with that. Part of the question, though, is what's being asked is what loan did it pay as to which one of the loans was being repaid.
We did
multiple loans. I mean, you've cleared it up tonight, but there was multiple loans.
Right.
Which loan got repaid?
That's wrong.
And which line item was it put into?
Yeah, and 460 says,
wrong.
149 says, right. Pay the bonds first.
And
so,
460 is wrong.
Yeah,
this
so
supersedes 149.
That's
it wasn't
confusing.
Paying the bonds, it was paying the operating, the loan from the royalty fund in accordance with resolution 2014-460. And if you look at the second page, you'll see there is a column for under loans, the royalty fund. That is the net amount of what we've loaned them to date after the repayment.
Okay. Ms. Daniels?
Yeah, I'm a little confused, because the first one that she's talking about was in December, but then we amended it in February 11th of 2015, and the amendment does not specify what she was saying.
The amendment extends what the loan could be used for.
Yeah,
initially, the loan was supposed to be used for essential operating expenses, meaning salaries and insurance. The amendment extended what we could lend the money for to include entertainment, Cajun Hot Sauce Festival, pretty much anything that they needed. Since the amendment was silent on the terms of repayment, I'm in the understanding and the impression, my experience as a CPA, the terms have not been changed. Only what the use and the purpose of the funds could be used for changed.
Okay, but my question is for legal. With this amendment, does this supersede the other one that they had, the previous one, since we amended it?
Politely stated, these four resolutions are a mess.
Okay.
All four of them don't say the same thing.
Okay.
And I think Mr. Ditches or Mr. Brown, whoever it was, said that it needed to be clarified. I think that's exactly what needs to happen. Everybody needs to get on the same page as to how that needs to take place. That would take care of any
we'll fix that.
And by saying that,
everyone needs to keep
would you mind?
Yeah.
What's your wishes, Mr. Broussard?
The biggest thing I was trying to get clarification is to what fund did it pay? And she answered.
Okay. It just says, so we're going to take no action at this point.
Well, I mean, we're going to have to come back and run it through committee. But the question was, what money was extracted? The commission wanted to know where it went. I don't think they had an answer. I was trying to get an answer as to what fund she said it paid back the royalty fund. In essence, it's paid off the total amount of that resolution. So
no, it's paid a portion.
Yeah. I thought that original resolution showed a $50,000 limit.
Y'all amended it to add another $85,000 to it. In January, resolution 2015-49, you added another $85,000 to that loan.
Yeah.
So we'll take it under advisement and
we'll clean it up.
Yeah, and it's, thank you.
Thank you for
that was the thing.
So we'll take no action on item number 312. Take it under advisement. I would like to address summary number 326. If you on this bottom of page 4, summary number 326, introduced by Troy Como, District 5, a resolution amending a fund budget in the amount of $25,000 to provide funding for the SLCC's International School for Aviation Excellence, with the said funding source to be determined during discussion of this item. The Finance Committee recommended to provide funding of $50,000 with the 2015 royalty fund budget as said funding source.
Moved
by Mr. Duncan.
Second
by Mr. Gonsolin. Discussion? Questions? Yes, it is changed to 50. We had hoped that the airport authority would be able to put up 25. FAA said that that is not acceptable because the phase one of this school is not going to be on airport property. Phase two is expected to be. The airport plans on kicking in their share in phase two at this point. There's a sense of urgency that we move this forward. The school is applying for a $1.5 million grant on Friday. We also would like, who made the motion? Yes, Mr. Gosselin?
Yeah, we got an email today from Ms. Hart. Ms. Hart, is it Ms. Hart?
Natalie.
Ms. Natalie, that she needs a letter stating that we're going to apply the funding to this project. So I'd ask for a substitute motion that we attach a letter to her in that respect.
Showing support for the project.
Showing support for the project for my funding. And she's here tonight.
Mr. Broussard?
My question was, I thought it was $50,000 for 3 years for a total of $150,000.
Yes.
This is only releasing 50. Does that actually do what they need to do?
No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't.
Thank you for clearing that up.
Okay, I guess that's the first part. So the number should be 150, not 50.
50 in over 3 years, right?
With a drawdown of 50 per year for a total of 150, what I think she needs. That's
correct.
The first part. But also that if other monies could be used in the sense that if we worked out something that the airport commission would actually take ownership of the facility, then we possibly could have them match some money, and those monies would pay back the royalty fund at that point. I think yes. We talked about having that verbiage also in.
Correct.
So I don't know if that's in there, but I'd like to make sure. I'll offer a substitute motion that it goes to 150 over a three-year period with a $50,000 per year drawdown. I think that'll meet the needs that you needed. With the letter of support, but also with the stipulation that if it is worked out between the school and the airport commission and all other bodies involved, that the airport commission does take ownership of that building, then that fund could be paid back with other monies from either the TIF or the airport authority paying part of that money themselves. Okay.
Okay, we have a substitute motion by Mr. Broussard and second by Mr. Gosselin.
Correct.
Any other questions? Discussion? Roll call. That motion?
That does what you need.
Yes. That motion carries. Good luck Friday. Hopefully you'll get that another million and a half.
Just a point of information on this. I think it was noted today on the news that a report came out that there is a huge shortage of air traffic controllers in the United States, and this would be a good, you know, incentive that college works with the airport authority to also try to introduce that program in, that we try to train and educate air traffic controllers also for the demand that's out there. So just I would ask that be brought into it also.
Good luck on Friday. Okay. Summary number 313. Back on page 3. Introduced by Jerome W. Fitch, District 11, a resolution of no objection to the naming of an 8-acre cape located at the southern end of Round Island at Scarrett Point.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Fitch.
Second.
Second by Ms. Arnold. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 314, introduced by Bernard E. Broussard, District 6, a resolution authorizing the execution of an intergovernmental agreement with Iberia Parish Hospital Service District Number 1 for the use of the building formerly used as a Generette Health Unit to be used as the Generette Rural Health Clinic for a period of 3 years, beginning on November 1st, 2015 through October 31st, 2018.
I yield to Ms. Arnold.
Moved by Ms. Arnold. Second by Mr. Fitch. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 315, introduced by Troy Como, District 5, a resolution authorizing a change in the regular meetings of the Iberia Parish Council from November 11th, 2015 to November 10th, 2015, and from November 25th, 2015 to November 24th, 2015.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Brown, second by Ms. Daniels. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 316, introduced by Maggie F. Daniels, District 1, a resolution amending the 2015 Airport Authority Fund Budget in the amount of $14,295 to accept grant funding from the Louisiana DOTD for the instrument landing system.
Move.
Moved by Ms. Daniels, second by Mr. Davis. Discussion, roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 317, introduced by Ackland Reno Arnold, District 12, a resolution amending the 2015 Airport Authority Fund Budget in the amount of $9,000 to accept grant funding from the Louisiana DOTD for the rehabilitation of the rotation beacon support structure at La Mer Memorial Airport.
Move.
Moved by Ms. Arnold, second by Mr. Fitch. Discussion, roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 318, introduced by Bernard E. Broussard, District 6, a resolution amending the 2015 Sewer District Number 1 Fund Budget in the amount of $30,000 in order to relocate sewage lines as part of the Port of Iberia Drainage Project, all to be funded from the fund balance previous year's line item.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Gonsalas. Discussion, roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 319, introduced by Lloyd Brown, District 4, a resolution amending the 2015 Criminal Justice Fund Facility Fund Budget in the amount of $21,394 to provide funding to provide for our dental cart and dental instruments and supplies, all to be funded from the fund balance previous year's line item.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Davis.
Second.
Second by Ms. Daniels. Discussion, roll call. That motion. Someone else stepped away. Ms. Arnold stepped away. That motion carries. Summary number 320, introduced by Bernard E. Broussard, District 6, a resolution approving a list of projects to be included in the fiscal year 2016-2017 Louisiana Capital Outlay Application and further authorizing transmittal of said application by Menville and Associates Incorporated.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Broussard.
Second.
Second by Mr. Fitch.
I want to make sure, didn't we add also one for the port? Is that included in this? The port was asking for that small piece of road. I thought we did an expansion after. We came back after the fact.
They were going to do the match.
Yes. So I would ask.
No, a road that, project throughout the port, I think.
Yeah, but I think that was part of the capital outlay request. I would ask so. That
make
also
sure that's
be included
included
in that, if it's not.
Yes,
yeah. We actually
it was a
special finance. I want to say we pushed it through, or we had a meeting, a special meeting before finance.
If we had an expansion, maybe.
So
I'm not sure,
but
yes,
I would ask that that be included in that list.
I think it was, but it's a good idea to make sure. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 321, introduced by Lloyd Brown, District 4, a resolution amending the 2015 general fund budget in the amount of $11,500 to provide a carryover for funding for the Council on Aging van, previously authorized by resolution number 2014-297.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Brown, second by Ms. Daniels. Discussion, roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 322, introduced by Bernard E. Broussard, District 6, a resolution requesting the Louisiana Department of Transportation and Development to install traffic circles at A, the approach ramps intersecting with US 90 and Louisiana 83 Weeks Island Road, and B, the service roads intersecting with US 90 and LA 83 Weeks Island Road, and further requesting the Iberia Parish Legislative Delegation to support this request.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Duncan. Discussion, roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 323, introduced by Bernard E. Broussard, District 6, a resolution requesting the Louisiana Department of Transportation and Development to install traffic circles on Louisiana 675 Jefferson Island Road at its intersections with US 90 on both sides.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Davis.
This is just for clarification. I think the proposal right now is only on one side, and this is asking for the other side to be included.
Any other comments? Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 324, introduced by Bernard E. Broussard, District 6, a resolution requesting the Louisiana Department of Transportation and Development to conduct a traffic study for improvements to the intersection of LA 3212 Northwest Bypass Highway and US 90 Service Road in order to improve traffic congestion at peak driving times.
Move
by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Gonsalas.
And this, make sure it's noted, is the short-term gap to correct the situation until the traffic circles are built, that it alleviates some of the problems.
Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 325, introduced by Troy Como, District 5, a resolution amending resolution numbers 2009, 193, and 2011-10, which granted five final approvals to Paul Segura Memorial Industrial Park, phases 1 and 2, respectively, in order to provide amendment to the dedicated right-of-ways. Move by Mr. Wayne Romero.
Second.
Second by Mr. Gonsalas. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Mr. Gonsalas?
I forgot to make a statement during Councilmember 9th announcement that DOTD met with our state legislatures today, and they are going to proceed with the traffic circle at Donnell Road and Lowellville Road. Should be December groundbreaking. So the right-of-ways are purchased and the green light's going some order.
Meeting. Ms. Brown?
I forgot to make an announcement that don't forget that the amendments that the Home Rule Charter that we worked on for some time, that we don't forget that we supported those five of them.
And it is early voting right now, and election day, October 24th. Ms. Daniels?
Yes, I'd like to take this time to thank our council clerk and his staff for putting out the pink ribbons. It's just a very touching thing for me. I've been here for quite some time, and it's the first time this has ever happened. I know you just didn't do it for me, but anybody that's watching it that has a survivor or is a survivor, I'm sure they appreciate it. So thank you, Brady.
I still have your pin, Ms. Dan. My pin that you gave me.
That's right. That's your pin. Got it. I'm so proud. And our legal advisor needs to get a pink shirt.
A pink hat.
He did not get that email, I'm sure. Can I get a motion to adjourn? Move by Mr. Broussard, unanimous second.
All right, that's it.